right, so Ankit, this is the book. It's out, and I hear it's going to be in the bookstores in early July.
Yes.
Okay, Ankit, so let's start with some big questions about technology. Now, it's technology is pervasive. It's in all parts of our life, from the moment we wake up to the moment we go to sleep, from electronic toothbrushes to cell phones to computers to ubiquitous computing to cloud to God knows where it's going. The science fiction writer Arthur C. Clarke once said that any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. Right? Has technology reached the point of magic today?
I certainly think it has. And example that immediately comes to mind is Siri. Who would have thought, say, even 5 or 10 years ago, that it would be possible to have an intelligent human conversation with a cell phone? And on most occasions, the cell phone knows more than you do. And I wouldn't be surprised, there will be a time where Siri realizes that, you know, the human being who's controlling Siri or asking all these questions to Siri is actually an inferior product. And Siri decides to, you know, turn against us and takes a life form of its own.
So for all of us who have seen the movie Terminator, has everybody seen Terminator? Or we have very young people in the audience who were born after the movie was released. Everybody has seen Terminator. Right, in Terminator, there's a piece of software called Skynet, which is a metaphor for the internet. And at one point, Skynet achieves what is called consciousness, which means it realizes that it needn't follow Asimov's famous 3 laws of robotics and that it can make decisions for itself and for humanity. And it decides that one of the key decisions that humanity is no longer needed.
Yeah.
Right? It's scarily similar to Google, which knows what I'm looking for before I finish typing my sentence.
Oh, absolutely.
Google is pretty close to Skynet.
And
so my serious question for you, how far are we away? Is it ever going to happen that technology acquires a consciousness of its own? And if so, how many days, years, or months away is it?
I think we have become so dependent on technology that humans are almost learning to stop using their brain. Because I have a lot of friends who have young kids, and whenever they're asked a math problem, they want to go to Google and just type the math problem into the Google prompt, and they get the result. And they quickly tell their mom and dad, say that, Mama, why do I need to know math when I have Google? So I think technology is just overpowering our entire lives, or we are becoming so dependent on it. And another great example is that there used to be a time where I could remember telephone numbers. But now, if I don't have my cell phone with me, it's almost impossible for me to get in touch with people that I know. So I think the dependence on technology has increased so much that I wouldn't be surprised very soon if technology realizes that, you know, human beings need us more than we need the human beings.
Right. So I'm reminded of a quote that Einstein once famously said when he was asked for the number to his house. He said, I have no idea. He said, why should I remember what I can write down in a book? So I'd like to challenge you on your contention that technology is making us dumber. Is it? Or is the new intelligence learning how to use Google better? Why should I know math if I know how to do Google?
I think, obviously, technology is a great enabler. There are a lot of positives to technology. And I love technology. I'm one of those guys who I personally feel my life has become a lot more efficient and a lot more productive because of technology and a lot more fun as well. So I've embraced technology to the fullest. There are still people who are a little bit scared of technology because obviously technology has a dark side. But what is interesting is that human beings are the dark side of technology. It's other human beings who want to misuse technology to harm others. So it's not really technology harming you, but I guess everything has to be in a balance.
Right, for those of you who are not complete geeks like the two of us, there's a famous law in technology called Moore's Law, invented by Gordon Moore. So which says that the speed of computing technology, processing power, will double once every 18 months. So whatever your computer can do, it will do it twice as fast in 18 months' time, the next generation of chip. Now, this has been one of the cornerstones of technological advancement. It's also the reason why you need to keep on changing your computer every 2 years. Every 18 months, Intel introduces a brand new chip, AMD introduces a brand new chip, which actually is a fundamentally new way. And the next big wave, I guess, will be graphene membrane technology, which will render everything that you own completely obsolete. You're going to have to buy completely new computers once again, right? So this law has held us since what, the 60s? Moore's law?
Yes.
Is technology progressing faster than what Gordon Moore predicted? Are we moving even faster than doubling processing speed every 18 months?
To be very honest, the Moore's law has been adapted several times to suit the rate at which the processors are actually doubling. So earlier, I think it was every 2 years it doubles, then it became every 1.5 years, then they again change it back or something like that. But I think we have reached a point where processing power is already so powerful that by just buying the new processor 2 years later, it's not going to actually significantly change our user experience. Because to be honest, think about it. How much processing power do we really need to be able to access Facebook or to be able to watch some videos online or to just use the day-to-day, you know, use a computer for day-to-day applications? So for, you know, everyday users, it really, you know, the Moore's Law is kind of irrelevant. But for Intel or for a lot of the manufacturers, it's almost a great marketing tool to be able to say that, hey, we're going to double the power we give you every 2 years. But do we really need that?
Okay, it's a good question. Do we really need that?
I don't think so.
I really need it, frankly. I don't know about you. Right. You spoke about Siri a little while ago. And one of the big questions in the technological world is the question of Apple survival.
Yeah.
Right. They had a big blow up with Apple Maps in the post-Steve Jobs era. And a lot of industry watchers and Apple fans and everybody else is all saying that Apple will not survive the death of Steve Jobs, that he built a brilliant company, but he built a one-man company with no technological process, no management process to continue innovation. So my question to you, will Apple survive or will it become irrelevant?
I mean, it's hard to answer that, but I personally love Apple. I can't imagine a single day without my iPad. And I think I really respect Steve Jobs for the kind of innovation that he's brought in. He's changed the way we interact with, you know, content or with cell phones or even or brought about the whole tablet revolution. But it's almost like, you know, he was almost the big DNA of the company. And it's Apple is struggling ever since he passed away. So it's hard to say. But I just feel that Apple has taken such a big lead, you know, compared to a lot of their competitors. And it's almost like cool to have an Apple product. So people have this, you know, thing that, hey, I want to own an iPhone. Are the features in an iPhone really different from, say, a Micro Max? Maybe not. To some level. So it's almost an aspirational value that is attached to an Apple product, and they have a lot of cash. So Steve Jobs may not be around, but Steve Jobs has ensured that they're sitting
enough
on a lot of cash.
Money to survive.
And they could, you know, buy a few startups and make sure that they continue reigning the whole, you know, technology world.
And what of Microsoft?
See, Microsoft is another classic example where there's a company that was really successful, you know, collected a lot of cash, but then unfortunately they became so big.
They haven't done anything innovative in years.
Yeah, they could not innovate after a certain point of time. So I hope that doesn't happen with Apple. But okay. I guess you know, the DNA of Apple is very different from Microsoft.
Okay. My last question for you before we get into your book. So Apple, Microsoft, Hewlett-Packard, Google were all startups at one point of time operating from garages in Silicon Valley and elsewhere. If you were to bet, if I gave you $4 million and told you to place four $1 million bets on four technologies or four companies which are going to be the Apples, Microsofts and Googles of tomorrow, where would you put your money?
To be honest, if I knew the answer to that question, I would take your $4 million and start that next big company.
Okay.
But in general, I think, you know, 3D printing is something that really excites
that's
me.
That's big technology. Okay.
And so for those of you who don't know, but 3D printing is basically the ability to print actual objects, not like a 2D paper, a 3D object at home. So imagine that, especially for all the women or the girls in the audience, imagine that e-commerce will one day become or reach a stage where you go to a website, put in your credit card details, click on buy or print, and your printer actually prints your purse or your product right there for you.
Why only for women?
Oh, I mean...
I buy shoes and purses as well.
I mean, it's just that women are likely to get more excited by that.
No. What do you mean? Are the men excited by 3D printing? Recently, there was a controversy when a gun was 3D printed.
Yeah.
They reprinted the entire components of an actual gun and you could assemble it and make a weapon for yourself. We'll get to that question a little later. Okay, so 3D printing is one big technology.
3D printing is one. The second is wearable computing. I think cell phones have ensured that we're always connected. And cell phones are always there in your pocket, but why should it be in your pocket? Shouldn't your gadget or shouldn't your connectivity to the rest of the world be on you? So I think wearable computing is really exciting as well. I think these are the two main areas that I'm excited by. I wish I had a perfect answer to your question.
Okay. I'd add genetic computing to that. That's going to be the next big leap. If you can take the human genome and create medicines and create customized technology that will suit your body exactly. Okay. I would put some money there, but then it's your money, not mine anymore. Right. So, Ankit, let's get to your book. It's called Faster, 100 Ways to Improve Your Digital Life. So, a lot of the things that you've suggested in this book, I'm going to give you a couple of examples. You actually tell us how you can catch a cheating spouse or partner using technology. Yep. How many people have had cheating spouses or partners? Nobody's going to put up their hands. Obviously. I know. Right. Let's assume at least 30% of the audience has had or suspected that their partner was cheating on them.
Well, let me rephrase this question. How many of you would like to be able to spy upon somebody else's mobile phone?
It's borderline illegal, but yeah.
So I think everybody is interested. Everybody is fascinated by being able to do things that other people cannot, or by being able to see what other people are up to. I mean, why is Facebook so popular? Because sitting in the anonymous room, a nondescript room in your house, you can actually find out what all your friends are doing. You don't need to call them up. You don't need to talk to them, but you know exactly what they're doing.
Okay, so how do you do it? How do you spy on a cheating spouse or partner?
All right, so if you want to spy upon somebody else's cell phone, make sure that you have physical access to it. So maybe if it's your friend or girlfriend or boyfriend, you can say that, hey, I need to make an important phone call. Once you have access to it, there are a couple of free software that you can download onto the cell phones. There's a software called Flexi Spy, Mobile Spy, and there are a couple of others as well if they don't work out for you. You got to install them. The best thing is they're completely hidden. So when you return the phone back to that person, if they scroll up and down on their phone, there will be no new icon that appears anywhere notifying them that something has been installed. And once you've installed it from anywhere in the world, you've got to log on to the online website and you can spy upon everything on their phone.
Next question. A lot of us have been victims of cyber fraud, cyber stalking, somebody squatting on our Facebook page, on our name. What do you do if you're attacked by cyber fraud, if you are the victim instead of the perpetrator, like in the previous example?
So I think, a very common crime or problem in India is that somebody can create a fake Facebook profile using your real picture, your real phone number, and they would actually put up some obscene messages or start tagging your friends on pictures and things like that. So if you become a victim to such a crime, number one, you gotta report that profile as fake to Facebook and tell all your friends to do it. Because if only one person reports it as fake, Facebook is not going to bring it down. So make sure as many people as possible report it as fake. If even that doesn't work out, there are cyber cells or police cells across India where you can actually report the cyber crime and they would get in touch with Facebook and hopefully they'll be able to bring it down.
Right. I'm seeing in your book, it's divided into four chapters, functionality and productivity, look and feel, security and fun stuff. So obviously I'm going to go to fun stuff straight away. Right. How to get a fake incoming call to get you out of a sticky situation.
All right.
I normally ask a friend of mine to call me, but I don't need to ask a friend
to
call me anymore.
You don't need to ask your friend to call you anymore. So imagine that you're on a date and it's kind of boring and you need to get out of the date and you don't want to, make the other person feel a little insulted or make her feel bad or make him feel bad. All you got to do is open up the app on your phone. The name of the app is Fake Call and Fake SMS. And you can type in the number from which you want the fake call, the time at which you want the fake call, schedule the phone call, and a few minutes later, your phone will actually ring. And the best part is, you can also make use of any of the pre-recorded conversations. So when you pick up the phone, if the other person is very close to you, they'll actually hear an actual voice on the other end of the phone. So it can be really, really accurate and really, it'll seem like a real phone call.
Okay, another big concern I have is, basically I want to lie, okay? But technology is making it harder and harder to lie. Facebook indicates where I've been last, WhatsApp says when I last accessed WhatsApp, whether I've actually read the message or not. I feel like I want to be part of the digital world and I want to share my life, but I also want some level of privacy.
Yeah.
So give us your top 3-4 tips for WhatsApp, Facebook, various other applications. If you don't want to reveal where you are, what you're doing, whether or not you've read a message, whether or not you've been to South Bombay in a bar or not, I don't want to reveal stuff
like
that.
So Suresh, how many girlfriends do you have that you need to actually hide what you're doing?
Okay, I'm refusing to answer that question. Let me just say one, I'm a one-woman man. But if I were not,
Okay. In case you're not, then what do you need to do? So how many of you use WhatsApp? All right. I'm sure all of you know that in WhatsApp, there's a last seen at status message, which basically tells all your friends, what was the last time that you're online? Now, that can be really annoying, because imagine that there's a friend that you don't like too much, and you maybe you like them, but you just don't want to talk to them right now. They send you a message. Now, most of us, we are scared that if we read the message, they will know that you have read the message, but you've not chosen to reply.
That is super annoying.
So it's actually extremely easy for you to read the message without letting them know that you've read it. All you got to do is switch off the Wi-Fi feature of your phone, switch off the mobile data on your phone, then open up WhatsApp, read the message that you want to avoid, message all the other friends that you don't want to avoid, that you want to stay in touch with, then close WhatsApp, switch on Wi-Fi, switch on mobile data, and the person that you're trying to avoid will have no idea that you came online. As simple as that.
Okay, that's quite simple. Another common problem that lots of people have is two things. One, they lose their phones.
Yeah.
Right? Or second, famous computer crashes.
Yeah.
Very few people back up their phones, very few people back up their computers. And the third thing that we face is that we choose passwords such as QWERTY or the password which is your name spelled backwards.
Yeah.
So let's start with the three big tech breakdown problems. One, I lost my phone. What should I do? What should I have done before? And if I didn't do that, what should I do now?
All right. So if you have already lost your phone and if you're using an iPhone, there is a software called Find My iPhone, which is usually pre-installed in most iPhones, at least the later ones. So you could log on to the Apple iTunes store and you could actually access the Find My iPhone app and you could use that to trace your phone. In case you're using an Android phone, there's a software called Plan B. Even if you have not installed any mobile tracing software before you lost your phone, you can still trace your phone on a Google map. And let's assume that...
What if you forgot to note down your IMEI number and stuff like that?
You don't need the IMEI number at all.
Okay.
Because on an Android phone, your phone is linked to your Gmail account. So all you got to do is go to the Play Store, go to search for the Plan B app. It will remotely install the Plan B app on your lost or missing phone. So even if it is in some other part of the world, it will get installed. And then you'll be able to see on a Google map where exactly your phone is. And if it's somewhere that you know that there's no way you can recover it, you can at least remotely wipe off all data from your phone.
Can I remotely copy all data back from that phone to me? That's tough.
So there are some premium software that you need to pre-install on your phone before you end up losing it. Then maybe you could recover your data.
Can I cause the phone to explode in the face of the guy who stole it from me?
You can, but for that, you know, you'll have to pay me a lot of money.
All right, okay. Good answer. Right, so lots of fun stuff in this book. Like I said, it's divided into four sections, functionality and productivity, look and feel, security, and fun stuff, and lots of tips. Okay, Ankit, I'm going to ask you a couple of questions about morality now.
Sure.
Now, a lot of the stuff that you've said in this book can be very useful for productivity, for fun, for security. The same stuff can also be used to commit crimes. You can actually install a piece of software on somebody's phone and spy on them. You can hack into somebody's email account. You can basically commit crimes and cover your tracks pretty easily with the tips that you're offering. So where do you stand on this? Do you fear that your book might be used by, not people here, people here are nice people, but people unlike these people who might have criminal bents of mind?
See, to be honest, knowledge is really powerful. And knowledge can be used positively, it can be misused in the negative fashion as well. But just because there's a risk that it can be misused, that doesn't mean that you stop sharing knowledge. Because to be very honest, if somebody wants to commit a crime, they don't need to buy my book. They have the best book available free of cost to them, which is google.com. So if you go to Google and type how to hack somebody else's cell phone, you'll get hundreds of blogs or YouTube videos that anyway show you how to do it. So what I'm trying to do is give that knowledge to everybody else. And if you know, like a lot of people in this room may not have even known that these things are possible. So at least now you know that, hey, that it is possible for somebody to spy my phone. So let me actually take the precautions. Because one of the sections in my book is security, where I actually talk about how to protect yourself against all the different fun stuff that I talk about in the fun stuff chapters in my book. So I think there's always two sides of the coin. And a very good example, which I like to share with all of you, is that, you know, you have all these car driving schools, so they teach you how to drive a car. Now, by just sharing that knowledge, the act of sharing that knowledge is not negative. But there are people who, after they learn how to drive the car, they decide to break the laws, they decide to overspeed, they decide to drink and drive, and they actually cause harm. So just because some knowledge can be misused by somebody, the knowledge itself does not become bad.
Right, and the security question is pretty important because based on recent reports from Norton and other security experts, two out of three Indians are victims of cybercrime. That's about 60 plus percent of India has been the victim of some sort of cybercrime, from phishing, which is stealing your credit card and password details, to cyber fraud, to somebody selling you fraudulent email, to somebody hacking your account, to somebody cloning your credit card. All these things seem to be getting easier and easier to do. Do you see a future where our number one concern will be cybercrime and not real crime anymore?
Absolutely. I think with every passing year, you're seeing more and more technology coming into different aspects of our lives. So, say 10 years ago, many of us could not even buy our tickets online. But now most of us in this room are probably buying our travel tickets online. So I think as we use more and more technology, it's going to open up more opportunities for the criminals to misuse the technology and harm us. So you got to be extremely careful about simple do's and don'ts that you need to remember while you're using technology.
Okay, and many of those are in the book. Yeah. Okay, let's move from the negative side of technology back to the positive side. One of the things that we saw last year during the Anna Hazare movement and protest was a massive use of technology, from India Against Corruption tweeting to Facebook pages to SMS chains to WhatsApp. Now, many people in this room are potentially citizen activists who would like to put some time and energy behind a cause, get a group of people together, petition the government, file a PIL, file an RTI application. Give us a broad sense of how technology can help you be a better citizen.
So I think the government is actually really scared of technology, because for the first time, the average person has almost a loudspeaker in the form of Twitter and Facebook, through which you can actually broadcast your views about the government or about anybody in the entire internet. And it's extremely easy for people to share something that they see. So if I've posted an opinion about some political figure and there are other people who agree with me, they're going to share it. It's going to grow like wildfire. So I think it's really changed the way people can express their opinions, both negative and positive, about anything. And there used to be a time where if you wanted to gather a lot of people at one place, it all depended on how many people you can quickly call. But now it's all about how many followers you have on Twitter and how many friends you have on Facebook. So I think technology is a great enabler for ensuring that the government becomes a little bit more answerable to the people who have voted the government.
And as in many things, it's a double-edged sword. There was this case of two British students who tweeted saying, "I'm going to destroy LA." And the word "destroy" in British parlance means, "I'm going to party. I'm going to kill it. I'm going to go and party like mad." When they landed in LA, they said, "Did you send this message saying, 'I'm going to destroy LA?'" And they said, "Yes," and they were deported. Right? They were. It's a real thing. Right? The Indian government at various points of time has tried to either censor Twitter and Facebook, or ask Google, Twitter, Facebook, everybody to appoint censors so that all content is pre-screened. There's a third component. Now, if you tweet something saying, "I know Ankit Fadia is a criminal," and put that on Twitter, you are legally liable in the same way that you are liable as if you printed it in a newspaper or put it up on a hoarding or said it at a public forum. The laws of libel, slander, and defamation will apply to you. Now, this is, to many people, is not obvious, because you have Twitter in your hand, you have it on your phone, you feel you can say whatever you want and who's going to catch me. But you can always get caught. Am I right?
Oh, absolutely. And it's amazing how, just because you're sitting in the anonymity of your room at home, it's a very comfortable room and, there's nobody with you, people tend to write things that they would never even dare
say in public.
People forget that whatever they're posting on Twitter and Facebook is actually a public forum. And, there's always a safety net, because you can always delete your comment later on if you change your mind.
Yeah.
So that's why people express a lot more.
Cyber footprints tend to stay on a lot longer than...
Oh, absolutely. Most people don't realize that.
Real footprints. Okay, Ankit, I'm going to open it to the house for questions.
Sure.
But before that, one last question to you. You've had your fair share of criticism. You're the author of many books. You were called a child prodigy. You went to Stanford. You have many things going for you. And you also have a lot of people who criticize you. Right? How do you deal with that criticism?
I think anybody who's in the public domain is going to have their own share of fans, their own share of critics. So I think it's part of being in the public domain. I encourage all kinds of opinions and
some feedback. Of this criticism is pretty personal, including your website being hacked multiple times.
Oh, absolutely.
Or being targeted, at least.
So I think that's all part of the game. I cannot be in the hacking world. I cannot be telling people that, hey, your website is vulnerable, your website can be hacked, unless even my website gets hacked. I think that just proves the point that I've been telling for a long time, that there's nothing known as 100% security. And you know, sooner or later, no matter what kind of security you have, somebody is going to be able to break in. And I think having critics, having fans, is a part of the whole game. And I welcome both fans and critics.
It's all par for the course.
Yep.
Right. Thank you, Ankit. Once again, the book is out. It's available at bookstores, you said,
yep,
in the first week of July.
Or on Flipkart.
And it's $200 a pop and on Flipkart. Now, before we conclude, Ankit is also a bit of a TV star and of late an internet star. You have a new show on YouTube.
Yep. So I recently started a show called Geek on the Loose. It's about how to stretch the limits of technology, how to have fun with technology.
If somebody can figure out this technology of every projector talking to every computer, I would bet $1 million on that.
Absolutely.
Company.
It's amazing.
The amount of time I've spent in conference rooms trying to connect a Mac to a projector and having it fail and press function F7 or F5 and struggling with it. There's an app idea. There's a technological idea. Make any computer talk to any projector seamlessly.
And Suresh is going to give the $4 million to the person.
One out of four. I'm so technological interconnection actually is a big game to play. From video conversion to audio conversion to making various pieces of technology interoperable with each other.
And I think gadgets or devices are changing so quickly that, you know, the connectors, they are not keeping up. So you got to, you know, live with that, unfortunately.
So this is an entrepreneurial idea. Are we ready? Are we over our technological crisis? Okay, we'll get to this in a little while. Let me go to the audience for questions.
Can you break down the Prism crisis for us, which, you know, recently took place? Edward Snowden leaking.
The Prism crisis.
And how threatened is an ordinary internet user by it?
To be very honest, I was not very surprised when I read about the Prism thing, because it's been going on for a while. For those of you who did not read about Prism, it's basically the US government is spying upon all communication on the internet, be it Facebook or your email or your searching or Twitter or whatever. So that's been going on for a while, because the only challenge is that there's just so much data on the internet. For the government to be able to make sense out of all the data that they're monitoring, I think that's a bigger challenge from a national security perspective. But for day-to-day users, unless you're a terrorist or unless you're doing something that the government may be interested in, you should not really worry about it. Because, I mean, an ordinary conversation between you and me, if you're exchanging emails, I don't really think that the US government would be that interested. It's not as if an actual person is reading the conversation. It's actually a software that is looking for certain patterns or certain keywords being communicated from specific email IDs or parts of the world. So, and of course, if you're still worried, there are ways to actually encrypt your communication so that the government cannot spy upon you.
Right, this is famous problem. So, like Ankit said, if you're not a terrorist, you have very little to worry about. What if you wrote this sentence, Bipasha Basu is a bombshell? She lives in a White House and is a fan of Barack Obama. So, remember, these are automated filters. It'll catch the word bomb, White House, and Obama. It'll ignore the context of your email. It's possible.
So technology cannot actually understand sarcasm or double meanings or the context. Which is why automatic filters never really work 100% of the time.
Prism uses automatic filters. So, on one hand, nothing to worry about. On the other hand, worry.
Yeah.
There's not much else you can do. Yes.
Can you tell me, like Twitter, some of the accounts are verified. So, how what's the process behind it? How do they do physical verification? How do they verify the account?
First, you need to be famous.
Yeah.
Then you need to prove that you're famous.
He is, but his account is not verified. That's what I checked last night.
So basically, there was a setting where you could basically fill up a form, send a request to Twitter saying that, you know, I'm a celebrity and I have X number of followers and you need to make my account a verified account. But correct me if I'm wrong, but there was a time where Twitter said that we're not going to verify any more accounts. So I'm not too sure whether that is the case, but I mean, there's a process where you can fill up the form and try to get it verified, but they do not verify it unless you're able to prove that you're a celebrity. They probably look at how many media articles have been written about you on Google and things like that.
So are you planning to get it verified yourself?
I mean, to me, it doesn't matter. I mean, whether it's a verified account or
not
matters, people are able
matters
to...
It matters to users. Like, when we see a verified
so
take...
So they know it's genuine. They know it's the real Ankit Fadia.
Well,
Ankit Fadia has also parody accounts.
Oh, absolutely. If you go to Facebook or Twitter, there are a lot of Ankit Fadias out there, which are all fake accounts. But if you go to my official page, and most people end up on my Twitter page through my official website, and then there's a link to my official
it's
Twitter
not necessarily
account.
That order, right?
I mean, I've not really thought about it. So, I mean, it's not, I don't see the value of doing it. I'm able to communicate with the people that I need to, and people who want to get in touch with me, they're able to get in touch with me. So, I think it's more of a vanity thing. A lot of people think that, hey, I have a verified account, so I'm a celebrity.
No, I think it's more of authenticity.
Got it.
For a lot of people, it's vanity.
We'll move on. So, Ankit, one of the things that's making me very happy today is normally when we do any geeky conversation, the room is full of only guys, actually.
Yeah.
Always. I'm glad to see the room is half filled with women.
Absolutely.
Are more and more women becoming geeks and techies these days? Is this a sign? A healthy sign for all of us?
It is, because I've been in this industry for the last 12 years, and usually it's like 5% women and 95% guys. So I think today's discussion is a lot more lively.
It's really heartwarming. This is the best part of the discussion for me.
With the invention of Sixth Sense technology by Pranav Misri, how long do you think handheld devices like the Apple, iPhone, the iPod, anything is going to be irrelevant? Pretty much redundant. That's what Sixth Sense technology does. He's invented this thing where you put your hand out, you have your phone on your hand. So how long do you think it's going to take?
The even cooler part of what he did was he went and bought all the components from a hardware store.
Yes.
He didn't invent anything. He bought existing...
He broke down the mouse. And
I think his self-imposed budget was $240.
Yes.
For $240, he went and bought pieces and he converted this incredible computer which he could wear on his body, project on the wall, write in the air, use his hand as a keyboard. So I'll answer first and I'll give it to Ankit. So these pieces of technology exist in different bits, right? Gesture control exists, handheld computing exists, wearable computing exists. But let's just say the killer combination, all of it, hasn't come together yet. And the killer combination will come from a Google or an Apple or a Sony or a Microsoft. So whichever company cracks it first and cracks it best will continue to be the company that survives. And the others will either follow suit. I mean, Nokia is still around. Not the most innovative company, but they haven't died, right? Even though they're not on the cutting edge of innovation. So the guy who cracks it or the girl who cracks it is going to have the million-dollar idea. But the others won't fall by the wayside. It won't happen overnight.
We are having so much of ethical hacking seminars and everything. So do you think, is there a future of having ethical hacking itself as a, you know, like engineering branch or something kind of study? So what do you think the future is? Because many people are interested in ethical hacking. There are a lot of seminars conducted in engineering colleges and other institutes. So what do you think about that?
That's a very good question.
I think ethical hacking is already a established career opportunity. Most companies have a full-time ethical hacker on their payrolls. And there are already colleges in India that offer a master's degree on cybersecurity or a PG diploma on cybersecurity. I personally have been offering in partnership with a couple of universities for the last 5 years. So it's already happening. And the industry and the government has recognized the importance of cybersecurity. They realize that we need to start officially training young talent to fill the needs of the industry. So I think the Indian government has published a report saying that India needs around 3.5 lakh ethical hackers by the end of 2015. So it already is.
Does everybody in the room know what an ethical hacker is? Anybody who doesn't know, put up your hand. We'll explain it for you. Yes. Can you explain in two sentences to what an ethical hacker is?
So you know what a hacker is? So if I hack into your Facebook account illegally, then I'm a criminal. But if you are a company and if you hire me saying that, come and hack into our systems and tell us what the security problems are, then I become an ethical hacker.
You don't hack for criminal reasons. You hack because you're telling people where your security systems are weak. It actually helps the people that you're hacking. Okay, we have to end. Can we end with the video of Geek on the Loose?
Yeah. Hello, everybody. Welcome to a brand new episode of the coolest tech show on the web. This is Ankit Fadia, and as always, I'm going to show you how you can stretch the limits of technology. In today's episode, we're going to see how you can send a secret message to your friend that automatically self-destructs, James Bond style, as soon as your friend finishes reading it. Keep watching. Next, a lot of times there's something very confidential that you like to share with your friends. Like maybe your credit card number, bank account details, or even maybe your password. Now the problem is, most people will just send that confidential information to their friends through email, chat, BBM or WhatsApp. But it's very risky. Because even after your friend has finished using that information, it still remains on their computer or mobile phone. So a criminal could actually access it and misuse that confidential piece of information.
So imagine your credit card details being stolen, and at the end of the month, who gets a hefty bill? You. And you know that you can't afford it. So instead, what you gotta do is, whenever you have something confidential you wanna share with your friends, just use a very useful website known as burnnote.com. Now, once you connect to burnnote.com, in this space provided, you can type in any confidential piece of information that you want to share with your friends. I'm going to go ahead and type in my credit card number. This is obviously not my real credit card information, so do not even try to misuse it. And you click on next, and in this space provided, you got to type in the username of your friend to whom you wish to send that confidential information. So I just typed in my friend Rohan Verma's name. I click on OK, and within a few seconds, the secret confidential message has now been sent to my friend. Now, whenever my friend logs on, he would have received a message in his BurnNote application. And to view the message, my friend will have to press that particular message. And within a few seconds, if all of you look at the screen, the credit card number, the confidential message has now been displayed on my friend's computer screen. And as soon as my friend finishes reading the message, within a few seconds, the secret message has self-destructed, James Bond style. As simple as that. So whenever you have something confidential that you want to share with your friends, just use burnnote.com. And please don't forget, all your credit card numbers, all your account details, all your passwords, if you want to keep them secure, just burnnote them to me. And trust me, I'll keep it very, very secure. Until next time, this is Ankit Fadia signing off.